Sapienza University in Roma, and he has held many different high profile position after working on many different experiments of high energy physics. And his position culminated into the presidency of the National Institute for Nuclear Physics in Italy. And he's also a member of the International Organizing Committee for the African School of Physics. So today we'll describe some of the knowledge and experiments about studying the dark side of the universe. Fernando?
Thank you very much. I will try to discuss the two issues that are most intriguing in our, not probably knowledge, on our ignorance of how the universe is made. Of course, we don't know many things about the universe. The first thing we don't know is how it was born. The Big Bang is a nice name for something that lets you think that there has been sort of explosion, but certainly it's not an explanation how you can pass from essentially the empty space where you have only quantum fluctuation from what we know into a real object where we live now. That's a bit difficult to explain. And of course, we have invented some explanations and theory. This is the theory of inflation, how the universe then became something which is almost homogeneous and isotropic, as we can see from our observatory on Earth. But also on the inflation, it's a nice theory, but it's not been confirmed essentially by any experiment or by any solid evidence. We know, since we have telescopes and we can observe the stars, and we can observe even the planets now, galaxies, a cluster of galaxies, even the scattered protons in the universe. We know that, however, that it accounts in case that the universe is, its geometry is flat, and it accounts only for 4% of the total density of the universe. That's a problem. I mean, all the matter we are made of, and all the matter we can observe, suggestive way, all the matter that shines, that makes light, is only 4% of what the universe is made. And of course, all of us have a question which probably is an intellectual curiosity, hoping that it doesn't happen and that doesn't fall on us, how the universe eventually end. Now, there is this statement once made by, I think, Secretary of State or Minister of Defense, I don't remember, Donald Rumsfeld, that tried to say essentially that there are things that we know, that there are things that we know, but that we don't know very well them. There are things that we don't know that they exist. So the famous known knowns or known unknowns. And of course, so probably we don't even know, we don't even think about them, okay? So we have to understand that when are in this landscape of things that some of them we know, some of them we hope we know that they exist, but we have not seen them, and there are things that we don't know whether we don't even think about them. So what we know is the standard model, okay, is the particles we are made of, the famous quarks, the forces, so the mediator of the forces. We know that the four fundamental forces of the universe have been, after the unification between electromagnetic and the weak force, they were reduced to three. We sort of know that gravity is a special force that doesn't like very much quantum mechanics, or perhaps in the other way around, and even calling gravity a force is a bit of excess because essentially gravity is the space-time itself. But at least we know the standard model pretty well. We keep confirming through observation the quality of the prediction of the standard model. Now we know that there is a lot of dark matter in the universe, probably 5-7 times more than the ordinary matter. So instead of 4%, probably 25-27%. And then we believe, however, not all of us believe, there is some evidence, eh? that the remaining part of the density of the universe is made by something that's really so obscure that we don't even have a nice word for it. We call it temporarily, say, dark energy, but we better like to know how we should characterize it and give a better name. So the standard model is, as you know, is made by the three families of quarks and three families of leptons. There are the quarks that we are made of. The normal matter is made of quark up and down. The atoms, protons and neutrons are made by up and down quark. The electron is what makes a proton becoming an hydrogen atom. And then there are the famous replicas of this basic element. So the three families, which are heavier than the one we are made of. Why three? We don't know. The only thing we know is that with three families, at least, you can invoke for the existence of charge conjugation parity violation, which is one of the ingredients that most likely is needed for explaining the matter and antimatter asymmetry in the universe. Then we have the mediator of the forces, the photons, the gluon, and the intermediate bosons. Photon and intermediate bosons are a combination of themselves. And then finally, in 2012, the last piece of the standard model was found at CERN. And this is the Higgs boson, the particle that coupling with all the others through a Yukawa interaction give mass to all the other particles. And okay, with this little Lego blocks, you can build the universe we can observe. I remind you, the discovery of Higgs boson in 2012. The Higgs boson was predicted by Professor Higgs and another paper by Professor Sprout and Englert. It took a good 60 years, more than 50 years from going from the prediction to observation. But as you know, physicists are very patient, and eventually Higgs boson was observed. I remind you that the prediction of another big discovery, gravitational waves, was made in 1916, and just 100 years after they have been observed through the interferometers in LIGO Virgo. So you see, this confirms that physicists are very patient, and if you want to become a physicist, you have to accept that you have to become patient. Okay, so the infamous 4% is what is the part of the iceberg which is below the level of the water. So we see the part that emerges about that is below. I send you a little movie which try to explain the reason for why we believe that dark matter exists. The movie is in Italian, but it's undertitled in English, so you should be able to understand it.
Noi, i pianeti, le stelle, le galassie, Siamo fatti di una materia che costituisce solo una piccola parte di ciò che esiste nell'universo. Rappresentiamo solo il 4% del tutto. Circa un quarto del cosmo, il 26%, è di materia invisibile che non sappiamo di cosa sia fatta e che chiamiamo materia oscura. La parte rimanente dell'universo è costituita da una componente altrettanto misteriosa chiamata energia oscura. La materia oscura non interagisce, se non debolmente, con la materia normale, però fa sentire i suoi effetti con la gravità. Per questo è stato possibile intuire già nel secolo scorso la sua esistenza. Osservando le galassie, per esempio, vediamo qualcosa di sorprendente. Per la legge di Keplero, le stelle più esterne dovrebbero ruotare più lentamente di quelle interne. Invece, si è visto che vanno incredibilmente alla stessa velocità di quelle più vicine al centro. La causa di questo fenomeno è una forza di gravità esercitata da qualcosa di invisibile. Questa cosa invisibile è la materia oscura, una sorta di nuvola, più grande delle galassie stesse. C'è un altro modo per individuare la presenza di materia oscura. Immaginiamo un occhio che riceve la luce proveniente da una galassia. E immaginiamo che tra l'occhio e la galassia ci sia una massa di materia oscura. La luce ci arriverà deviata. Così. 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 Poiché siamo in uno spazio a 3 dimensioni, le immagini formano un disco, un anello. È quello che si chiama l'anello di Einstein, la lente gravitazionale, un'altra spia dell'esistenza di materia oscura. Per fare un esperimento di come vedremo una galassia in una lente gravitazionale provocata da materia oscura, possiamo prendere la base di un calice, mettere al centro del punto di osservazione una galassia, ed ecco come appare il nostro anello perfetto. Oppure, spostando il centro della lente, vediamo questi, cioè come vedremo la galassia nel caso in cui non fossimo allineati. Gli scienziati stanno dando la caccia alla materia oscura, per esempio con strumenti inseriti nel silenzio cosmico di laboratori sotterranei, oppure con attività sperimentali nello spazio sulle stazioni orbitanti. Prima o poi capiremo di cosa è fatta.
Ok, so what I... Okay, what I now want to outline is that there is another problem, as I said, in the universe. There is the problem of the dark energy. It appeared. Okay, it appeared 25 years ago, so through some observation and the supernovae, and that were being observed for answering an important question actually about our universe. Now, before going into the description of how the evidence for dark energy appeared in front of us, I have to frankly say that if you ask me what dark energy is, I can only answer, I don't know. And I doubt that anybody on this earth knows what it is. And so I will not spend the words for trying to say what it is. But I can tell you what the evidence is for it. Okay, now, the fundamental question people wanted to answer is a question that is still there from the time when Einstein equations of the general relativity were applied to universe and were solved. So you have to ask yourself at this point if a supposed Big Bang is what you naively imagine is an explosion where all the matter is energy, whatever, is projected out. Now, you know that there is gravity, so you can ask yourself whether this explosion is such that all the components will expand forever, or they will expand, say, forever but asymptotically. So essentially at a certain moment the expansion will be so slow that you could stay that you are in a steady state, or that was a solution favored by many, that the strength of the gravity would have made the universe recollapse, and then you could imagine a cyclic universe that bounds forth and back. So this is the question that you want to answer. Now, you need to know essentially what is the speed of the expansion of the universe and how you do measure it. What you know essentially. Sorry? I must confess that I cannot hear. Sorry?
Is somebody asking a question or?
If somebody's asking question, I cannot hear though. Okay, let's wait for perhaps she can ask the question later. Okay, so now what we do? What we do is that we need, to measure a distance, we need a lamp which has a constant amount of sheds and a constant amount of light. Then you know that the number of photons you receive is proportional to inverse square of the distance. So you need essentially a standard candle in the universe. Now, standard candle in the universe, is a nice concept, but unfortunately you cannot produce an artificial lamp and move it around the universe. So you have to find something that nature provides for you. Apparently, the supernovae of a certain type are standard candles, meaning that inside 10% or so, that class of star will implode and produce a supernova, which have essentially a definite luminosity. So it cannot be twice as much, it cannot be half of it. So the standard candle you have. Now, of course, now that you have a standard candle, you know where that light come from. Because the attenuation is given by 1 of r squared. Now, this is essentially the knowledge that then you have to combine the fact that now you have a measure of the distance of a single object. You have to combine this with the Hubble law. The Hubble law says that there is a everything you look, everything in average, everything you look in the universe recede from where you are, so gets farther and farther away with a speed that depends on the distance. This is the famous Hubble constant, okay, which say essentially that with some uncertainty due to measurement, says that the Hubble constant is 60-70 kilometer per second per megaparsec of distance. So now if you have something at 1 megaparsec, it would reside at 60 kilometer per second, but if you have something at 1 billion parsec, then you have something that reside very, very fast. Okay, and this is something which you know, the Hubble law is known. The precise value of the constant is not known, but it's a linear relation. Now, you have another way of measuring whether the speed with which one star recedes from you, and this is the Doppler effect. No, the Doppler effect is what you experience in life with sound. No, with sound when the police car gets passing you, the frequency is shifted, and then when it gets away from you, the frequency is again shifted with respect to what you hear when you are really close to the ambulance, to the police car. Doppler effect. And now the Doppler, to measure the Doppler effect, you have to measure with light a line of an element that you know. Okay? Okay. Ooh. Yes. Sorry, I think here, then I go back to the slide. For example, take the hydrogen line. It doesn't matter. I mean, all the atoms have characteristic light, emit characteristic lights that are due to the jumps of the electron from one orbital to another. So you know the color of the light that is emitted by hydrogen. Now you can measure it from anything, from any star that you have in your line of sight. Module of your complication is the cosmic dust or other stupid things, but forget. And then you measure the shift in color of the light. Since it's going away from you, it gets redder and redder. So the frequency will get smaller and smaller. And at this point, you know what is the speed of the object given by the Doppler effect. Interesting. So now what you discover, what they have discovered actually, is what you see on the left side panel, which doesn't look so impressive at first glance, but it made Professor Fries Perlmutter to go to Stockholm for getting the Nobel Prize. So you see that z is the distance of the star measured in astronomical units. Astronomers, you know that distances, lengths are measured by physicists in very different ways. So accept that astronomers measure the distance in z. So you see that at the beginning it looks like a straight line, and the straight line would correspond to a universe where zero dark energy, everything is matter, okay? Everything is matter. Whether the matter is dark or the matter is ordinary, that doesn't really change the picture as long as both feels the effect of gravity in the same way. But you see that the points at very high z show a deviation from the linear behavior. And this deviation can be fitted. And the best fit comes out with the fact that matter is only 20% of the total density of the universe, and the rest is something that is not matter, 80%. And so this is the amount, more or less, of a dark component of the universe that we don't know. The residuals of the fit are shown in the bottom part of the plot. Now, one thing that I would like you to notice is that the right side panel is has a scale, horizontal scale, which has a zero. Zero is today. Then there are 10 billion of years before, 10 billion of years after, and now you know that the universe started more or less 13.8 billion years ago. And then you can model essentially everything that happened after expansion, after inflation, saying that in one model the universe at the beginning decelerated, then accelerated, or always decelerated, or did something else. You see that we are in a peculiar point, okay? Where the effect is the most difficult to detect, in a sense, no? Because we are in a point today where all the models give more or less the same prediction. modulo, you have seen the little difference that if you do accurate measurement, you can observe. But this is extremely important because then in few billions a year after us, the lines will diverge one from the other, and then you don't know whether it collapses, expands forever, or whatever else. So this is the situation. So you see that what we are in this moment, we are in the transition, apparently, no? In the flex point of a universe that where the expansion was slowing to the transition to a universe where the expansion is accelerating. Now, how can you get this this phenomenon? Well, if the universe is a matter dominated, then the expansion will be slowed. If the universe is dominated by this strange component that makes it much accelerate, then it will expand. Now, what is the transition point? Well, the transition point is where this component that makes a universe accelerate becomes dominant over the one where the universe would slow. The only thing that you can imagine is this component that makes the universe expanding is proportional to the volume of the universe, because the universe was little, and when it was little it was dominated by matter, and the component, if you have a component that wants you to expand, this component is modest because the universe is small. At a certain moment the universe becomes larger, larger and larger, and this component that is proportional to the volume of the universe becomes predominant. Okay, this is the poor man explanation of things. Okay, well, you see that this is something strange. I mean, how do you call something something that makes you expand? I would call anti-gravity in a sense. Okay, but I mean, these are just words for telling something that we don't understand. Okay. So you see that it's interesting that the universe will have a fate which likely, since we are in the time of continued acceleration, probably the universe will end up into what we call a big rip. I mean, everything will be tore apart. And even if your planet would survive, looking outside from your planet, you wouldn't see anything, because everything has been redshifted so far, so long, that you wouldn't observe anything else. Would be even difficult to make theories out of the universe where you only see black around you. Okay. So, you see that from what I said is that at the beginning the universe was matter dominated, but if it's true that a substantial part of the matter is dark, is a matter we don't know, the formation of galaxies, our existence is essentially due to the existence of dark matter. The universe will be destroyed by the existence of the dark energy. It's very how to say. It's a very unpleasant to know that we are here because something that we cannot observe, and we will disappear from here for something that we cannot observe. Well, interesting. This gives you the sign of our ignorance. Okay, dark matter. Let me talk a bit about dark matter. So dark matter is more frequent, apparently, than normal matter. So imagine this candy box, where the ordinary matter is the colored one and the other is dark. So apparently the universe is composed in this way from the point of view. How do we, what we know about dark matter? Well, what we know for sure is that it is governed by, it feels gravity. Okay, so we know that gravitationally is like the other matters. But then we don't know whether it is subject to we know that it's not electromagnetic because it doesn't make light. Okay, well, so we know something, gravity is gravitationally bound, but we know that it's not an electromagnetic, it's not subject to electromagnetic force, because otherwise it would shine. And how to find something that we don't know what it is? Well, of course, like others, are particle physicists, so we cannot look for something that is not our discipline. I mean, with all our fantasies, we have developed tools for finding elementary particles. So it's convenient, how to say, for us to go into an hypothesis that says that dark matter is made by particles. Particles that were created at the beginning of the universe, when the temperature was high enough to let them pop up. And then, since they don't decay, because they are not coupled to ordinary matter, perhaps they annihilate one another, we don't know. They have survived after the decoupling, essentially, when the temperature got lower. They permeate the universe as we know. Probably since they are subject to gravity, they are bound to galaxies. Okay, they are form an halo which encompasses the galaxy. Well, good. This is an hypothesis. It's not the reality. It's not the truth. It's an hypothesis, a working hypothesis for trying to spot the dark matter in this way. So, well, then if these are particles, then we can hope that one of them can hit a nucleus, the nucleus of an atom, or even an electron of an atom, and scatter it off. While we know that dark matter is not electromagnetic interaction, so we cannot trace the dark matter itself, if it displays an electron or a nucleus from its position, then we know how to detect this phenomenon. Okay. Now, of course, dark matter, if it has this kind of interaction should be very weak. Otherwise, since dark matter is more abundant than normal matter, and as we said, it's around us everywhere, we should suffer from the interaction of dark matter particles with our body even. So we have to assume that they have a very weak interaction. So it's rare that they can hit a nucleus. So we cannot hope to observe such a scattering if we go with a detector above ground in a place where cosmic rays are dominant and cosmic rays leave tracks of their existence inside your detector. So I remind you that muons are coming down from the sky at a level of many per centimeter square per minute, so it wouldn't make sense. So we go underground, we go to with detectors in an underground laboratory where the muons have been all absorbed by the rock which is above your laboratory, and you hope to see something popping up from nothing. I remind you that there is another particle, unfortunately, that behaves like that. We will discuss it. So one of the options is to go, for example, to Laboratorio Nazionale del Gran Sasso, with that they are 1 hour and 50 minutes drive from Rome. It's a gallery that connects the east side of Italy with the west side of Italy under the Apennine Mountains, under a mountain that is 3,000 meters high, which is the Gran Sasso mountain. So the laboratory has been excavated orthogonal to the highway, with three big holes, each of them pretty big, 100 meter long, 20 meter high, 20 meter wide, where you can put experiments inside. There are essentially the muon flux is reduced to almost nothing. Neutrons exist because they are emitted from the rocks around, but then you know how to, more or less you know how to cope with that. So now, to make your experiment, you have to guess something about dark matter. So the first guess, as I said, is that dark matter is gravitationally bound, so it's all around you. Okay, it's essentially a component which is inside the galaxy. Whether it is more dense in the center of galaxy than in the periphery of galaxy, these are debatable questions. Okay. The other hypothesis, of course, if you want to detect the dark matter in the way I've told you, is that it has to be made by elementary particles of an unknown nature that interacts very weakly from time to time. Now, there is a clever way, actually, that could help in detecting dark matter. Suppose that dark matter is essentially stationary, okay, in the galaxy. Then you know that the Sun is moving in one direction inside the galaxy. The Sun with all the solar system is rotating around the center of the galaxy. And so it moves in one direction. So at this point, you have a wind of dark matter that comes in front of you. Of course, now this by itself doesn't mean much. But of course, now you know that the Earth is going in circle around the Sun. So sometimes the speed of Earth, the velocity of Earth, will compose with the dark matter wind, sometimes against and sometimes in the same direction. So if you have a cross-section, the probability of collision, that depends on the velocity, and we are talking about essentially stationary things, so we are dealing with almost classic physics here. So the probability of interaction will be much higher when you go head-on against the dark matter wind rather than you escape from dark matter wind. It's like, if you go into a car and you are bumped from behind by a truck.
Excuse me, Fernando, we have a question here.
Yeah.
So, Adad, could you please ask your question?
Oh, please, thank you. How have you chosen the direction of dark matter wind to be in summer like that or winter in the other direction?
No, suppose that the dark matter is not going anywhere. So this is the effect of sailing boat, no? The apparent wind. When you go on a sailing boat, you have a wind in front of you, right? This wind doesn't exist, in fact, but you are creating that wind, no?
Yes, I got it, thank you.
Okay, so as I said, this would be a great way. And actually, there is an experiment at Gran Sasso where they looked for the probability of interaction inside their sodium iodide crystals for the dark matter. And what you expect essentially is a modulation that the cross-section becomes higher in a certain period of time of the year, and then decreases, and then increases, and then decreases, and go on. This is a fit that they have done to their data that are taking by more than 10 years. So this is a pretty convincing plot. I mean, you would say that they observe actually an effect which is pretty compatible with the hypothesis of dark matter we have made. Now we have, here we get a problem, because so from one side you say, okay, deal done, we have discovered dark matter. From the other, you say, okay, fine. Now, since the dark matter interacts with your detector, then the dark matter has to interact also with my detector. So if I put another detector in the same place, actually, where this one is, inside the laboratory, say laboratory, let's wait and observe the interactions. So, okay, so people taught two different techniques. Those are sodium iodide crystals. People said, okay, let's take a cryostat full of a noble gas, okay, noble liquid, xenon, for example. Okay, xenon is pretty big atom, so it should offer a sizable cross-section. And you have a noble gas, so if you create an electron, if you ionize a xenon atom, or if you produce anyhow some signal, electric signal out of xenon xenon atom, the probability that the electrons are reabsorbed by any other atom is zero, because there's no affinity. And so you can imagine at a detector that works like that. You have an interaction inside your cryostat, inside your volume. You create some electron, and these electrons are transported. These electrons, first of all, give some light immediately through scintillation in xenon. Then they are transported up to with an electric field up to another phase of the xenon, where they interact again as a sort of an avalanche, and you see the second signal. Now it comes without much of an explanation. It comes that the signal, the two signals are very different when you have a nuclear recoil or when you have an electron recoil. So you know what are the electromagnetic events and what are the nuclear events. Now it's important to know to separate these two categories, because of course, while you might be able to control the neutrons that come from outside, there is almost no chance to control the radioactive decays that produce photons everywhere. So essentially, you have to reject all the conversion, the Compton scattering, and other stuff like that. Okay, so this is this detector, which in this moment is the best in the world, at the best limit in the world, has a few tons of liquid xenon. The fiducial volume, it's only 1 ton, is the inner part of the cryostat. And for each, you see the black points, which are all confined in a certain region of the parameter S2, essentially are electron scattering, photon scattering on electrons. But there are events that are outside that region. And in particular, there are a couple of events that are a different thing. So now, for each of these events, at each of these events has been attributed a probability to be essentially something, a neutron, or a dark matter event for a certain mass, or whatever else. Now, in the table, you count the number of events you have observed and the background that you expect. So you see that toward the right side, you reduce more and more the fiducial volume, if you go in the inner part of the cryostat. So you eliminate more and more neutrons that come from outside. You might have few surviving neutrinos from the sun. And you see that eventually you have a total background of 0.8 event, and you have two events in that region. Now, this of course is not it's not a claim of a discovery, it cannot be. It's probably like saying, okay, we are observing the background that we control with a certain precision. However, this is completely incompatible, as we see from this plot, it's completely incompatible with the rate that was predicted by the experiment that looked at the modulation, okay? So you see that, you look on the right side. So the region which is allowed by the Dama Libre experiment is in gray, and xenon has this blue lines, and the blue lines separate two regions of the space. On the right side of the blue line, you exclude everything. You say there is no dark matter there. On the left side, you have not looked yet. You have no sensitivity for saying something. And on the left side, there is the entire separation of the two domains, but as a function of the hypothetical mass of the dark matter particle. So you have a contradiction, a clear contradiction between an experiment that say we have observed something looks like dark matter, and another experiment that say we do not observe anything like that you say. Now, There are a few things to notice. The mass of the why an experiment like Xenon does not look for the modulation, for the summer-winter modulation like DAMA. Well, there is a reason for it. DAMA is made by 250 kilograms of detectors that are very good scintillators, which allow a threshold as low as 1 kV. So it means that a nucleus recoiling with 1 kV will be observed. On Xenon, the sensitivity of the experiment start at tens of kV. So the number of events is definitely reduced. So you cannot count at this point on the modulation effect. You don't have enough events to observe a modulation. They have done some more work, which I will not describe, that however one could say, but the events that are observed in DAMA are not scattering of dark matter on nuclei, but rather scattering of dark matter on electrons. Yes, true. But looking at this part, the Xenon and the other noble gas experiment have excluded that possibility too inside their sensitivity. So one, but you see, there is something disturbing in a sense here, because there is some background, okay? I mean, these events you cannot really attribute definitely to neutron or to dark matter interaction or to neutrinos. So the hope is to find an experiment that really run with zero background, that can only observe dark matter scattering. Now, from this point of view, argon is much better than xenon. Argon can exploit the two parameters S1, S2 in a much more powerful way than xenon. So eventually, if you build an experiment with argon, you would be really background free. Why so far this has not been done? This is an interesting region. All the experiments done with noble gases, noble liquids are done with xenon. Well, okay, this one is, okay. So one experiment is being prepared based on argon, it's called Dark Side. We are full of dark here. And it can be as big as 20 tons, but it could even be bigger than 300 tons. This is the reason why this has not been done so far. Because you see, on the right upper side, you see that argon normally is argon 40, 99.6 of argon is argon 40 that you buy on the supermarket in bottles. However, there is something with 269 years of half-life, which is argon 39. You see, there is argon 37, but argon 37 is irrelevant because the half-life is 35 days. So once you have put your argon in underground after 3 months, that has disappeared. But argon 39 has a very long lifetime compared to your experiment, and it's a beta emitter. It's an electron emitter. Where argon 39 comes from? Argon 39 comes from the interaction of cosmic rays in the atmosphere. That is unpleasant. So you, because argon is a very, very, very big component of the atmosphere. So in fact, argon doesn't cost anything because it's a liquefied starting from air at a very low cost, distilled. However, argon 39 forbid to make experiments of this precision with argon. So what you have to know, you have to eliminate the component of argon 39. Okay, so one thing is that if you go in deep in a mine, you take the air deep in a mine, Well, that probably helps because that argon is not continually reproduced by cosmic rays that do not get into the bottom of the mine. So probably it has also had the time since the change of air is not very frequent. It's also a time to mostly decay. Indeed, for this experiment, the argon will be taken by mine in Colorado, and the measured argon that comes from there is poorer in 39 component by factor 300. Okay, that helps a lot. But if you are not happy enough, then you could do this. You know that through distillation, you can separate isotopes, you can elements, you can separate one element from another. Now here the problem is that you want to separate 39 from 40, so there is only a little difference of 2% between the masses. So you need a distillation column which is very powerful. So and this has been built, is to install into an abandoned or closing mine in Sardinia a distillation column for the separation, which is 300 meters high, will be cryogenic for saving electric power. And it's as high, as tall as the Eiffel Tower. The prototype is already in operation, is at 20. Now, once you have this column, you not necessarily you run it only for argon at this point. You can separate almost everything, okay? And so you will also produce oxygen 18, carbon 13, nitrogen 15, all things that are needed in other fields, mostly in medicine. Mostly in medicine. For example, oxygen 18. The oxygen with which you make the water then is put into a cyclotron where the oxygen is transformed into fluorine, and then this is used for the shot that they give you before a positron. So you said even when you are looking for the gold. So the dark matter, then you can have, if you think not even hard enough, you can have a social impact. Okay, now I want to go back a moment to the dark energy problem. You see, by itself, the accelerated expansion of the universe is something that should not really surprise us so much. Because as we know, universe underwent a period in when there was inflation. Inflation means that going from essentially nothing, from a material point, the universe expanded in a superluminal way in a very, very short time up to finite dimensions. And this was due, apparently, for what we know, to the existence of a potential. That forced essentially the universe to do that. Now, this sort of scalar potentials are mysteries that permeates our universe. One scalar potential is the X field. One scalar potential could have been the inflation field. Perhaps we have another scalar potential that provoke the acceleration now. Or perhaps there is only one scalar potential that behaves in a very complex way and we don't understand and we don't have yet the understanding of it. I want to remind you one thing. Everybody says that Einstein made everything right, and Einstein himself at a point said that he made something really wrong when he wrote the general relativity equation up in the right side. He thought without having solved properly the equation, he thought that the universe would have recollapsed due to the gravity. And he didn't like the idea, so he wanted to have a static universe. Now, this is another idea that probably, but this is probably a very stupid idea. But anyway, So to contrast the attraction of gravity, he introduced a parameter, a scalar, which he called cosmological constant, to the equation. It's not forbidden, it doesn't change much about the equation, except that this constant forced the universe to expand. He thought, I am forcing the universe to expand, the universe wants to recollapse, the two forces will balance, and the universe will become static. Now, the proper solution of the Einstein equation for the universe were done by Hubble and Lemaître, and they discovered that there was nothing like a recollapse, that the universe was expanding, actually. So at this point, Einstein went out and said, okay, I made something, a tragic mistake. I had put a cosmological constant, which is wrong, it's not needed, and I don't know why I did it. Well, 100 years after, the cosmological constant has come back. I mean, the accelerated expansion of the universe, for what we know, for all the measurements we have done, looks as it comes from a cosmological constant, just a number, which is a scalar, that tells this thing. Okay, so if this is true, this is the universe as it will be observed by any of humans, if they will exist, in, I don't know, 100 billion years from now. They won't need much physics at that point. Okay, so we are here. This is not the end of the story, of course. As you understood, we don't know many things. But as one great Italian scientist, the father of science, in a sense, of the experimental methods, Galileo, said, this is the beginning of a road. There are other brains, more acute than mine for sure, that will explore the most remote corners and will find solution to this kind of problems. Okay, that's it.
Thank you for this very nice overview of the dark side of the universe. So I guess some students have questions. There was one question by Adad, but do you still have a question, or was it the previous one?
I have another question, please.
Yes, please go ahead.
So thanks for the professor today presentation. It was really nice. I have a question if they can talk to us about what we read a few days ago about the possible discovery of a candidate of dark matter, please.
Yeah, I think this was in low mass candidates from the same from the xenon 1-ton experiment. Is that your question?
I mean, the discovery of something requires two something most as important as dark matter. I would say that requires two things. One is that in an experiment, and this is true for Dama Libra actually, the statistical significance of the effect it exceeds 5 sigma, and for Dama Libra this is not a problem, although then you have to transport the results to models to understand how to assign it to dark matter candidates. But then, as Galileo said, I guess, You need that in another laboratory where you do the same experiment, or in a laboratory where you do a different experiment but has the same probability, you observe an effect that is compatible with the claim. And now we are in the unpleasant situation where we have one experiment that claims a discovery, and no one else is able to demonstrate that discovery, I mean, to confirm that discovery, right? That's a problem.
Yes. Are there any future experiments that are project of future experiment to discover dark matter?
Look, now, As for this kind of dark matter, I think that xenon itself is now about to start an experiment which is five times bigger than the one they have run, so a few tons, and 5 tons or 8 tons. Then dark side will be an experiment in argon with 20 tons. One thing that I didn't tell you is, appear somewhere. Why should I put it, but I don't find it. Okay. And this kind of experiments have an intrinsic limit, limitation, which I forgot to put into a picture. At a certain moment, these experiments will start to measure solar neutrino interactions, okay? Which by definition, you cannot discriminate from dark matter scattering, because it's the same as the scattering that produces the displaced nucleus or produce an electron or whatever. So at that point, this kind of experiment will see the end of their story, okay? Now, the end of the story is not far away, in the sense that with 300 tons, for example, of argon, then you will start to see neutrino interactions. So you cannot push this technology much, much farther than that, first of all. Of course, you could change technology, improve technology, and try to use this experiment, sort of this experiment, in a way that they measure the direction of arrival of the neutrinos, because the neutrinos come from the sun. So if you could say the direction from which the particles that interacted came, you can, at every hour of the day and night, exclude those that come from the sun. So this would be a great improvement, okay? But then there is another consideration, that as I said, the fact that dark matter is made by particles of this kind is an hypothesis. But this hypothesis could be plainly wrong. Dark matter can be made by other objects that I cannot even think. Axions is another road for dark matter discovery. People claim that primordial black holes could make a substantial or a total contribution of dark matter. You see, here everybody has his personal bias, or his personal kind of the detector is able to build. So dark matter will be a long search, and I cannot guarantee, I mean, that I will see it discovered before the end of my life. And who knows, I mean, put a new, brand new and clever idea on the table, and this is what we need.
Yeah, I get it. Thank you, sir.
Yes. Maybe Saeed has two questions. Saeed, please go ahead. Ask your questions.
I think he's muted. No?
So I can try to read the first question. Why is the word dark chosen to describe or qualify the matter and the energy in the words dark matter and dark energy?
I know why dark has been chosen for matter, because it doesn't make light, okay? So dark matter is something that does not, is a kind of matter that does not make light. So essentially dark is because it does not make light. Dark energy, I think it's here dark is used in another way, in another meaning. This is rather obscure in the sense that we don't understand. So So it's there are two different meaning that we have to attribute to the adjective dark, to matter and to energy.
Now there is a second question talking about standard model and beyond standard model. Could you please explain the concept of MSSM in terms of what necessitated and how it's related to standard model and beyond the standard model?
The supersymmetry was introduced to solve a fundamental issue. The fundamental issue is that we don't understand why the Higgs mass is so low. Low meaning 125 GeV, but it would be the same if it were 300 GeV or 500 GeV. The point is that Higgs mass is coupled, as I say, through Yukawa interaction to every particles. Immaterially, if this is virtual or real. So if you do not have anything between the top mass and the Planck mass, one should naively think that the X mass gets transported toward the Planck mass. This is one reason. The second reason is that if you look at the evolution of the coupling constant of the electromagnetic electroweak interaction, strong interaction with energy, okay, then you see that around 10 to 15 GeV, they get almost the same value. Okay, almost the same value. Now there are corrections that you can make. This you can interpret as an accident of nature or a fundamental fact of nature. So if you want to make them, as I said, they sort of coincide. If you want to make them coincide, and then from that point on they would evolve all together, then you need an intermediate energy scale, which essentially corrects for the behavior. Now, so supersymmetry was essentially invented for solving these two issues. Now, of course, it makes sense if the particles, you know, supersymmetry, I remind you, that is essentially changing the spin of fields and particles. So wherever you have a particle, fundamental particles of spin 1 alpha, you will have a fundamental supersymmetric particles of spin 1. And wherever you have a field which has a spin 1, you will have a fundamental field of spin 1 alpha. So this is the symmetric world in a sense. So that it does make sense if these particles have a mass which is not far, 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 far away from the one of the standard model. Otherwise, to make them work, I mean, the correction happens through loops, right? So you have one loop where you circulate the top, fine, and that gives a contribution. Now, if you want to kill the effect of the top, you can kill with a supersymmetric particle that you put in the loop and gives a correction with a sign which is opposite to the one of the particle. However, if this particle that you put in the loop has a mass that is 1,000 times bigger than the top, then you have to invoke a coincidence, or if you want, a correction that works at 1 per mil level. And this is really unpleasant, no? It's what we call essentially the problem of correcting with too much precision, no? So minimal supersymmetric standard model was the, as the word said, was the simplest version of the supersymmetry, where the particles were very close to the one of the standard model. They should have been observed at LHC. The fact that LHC has not observed any supersymmetric particles, and we are at a level of 200 GeVs now, that makes a problem. Not a fatal one, but almost a fatal one. So it's very different from theory point of view if beyond standard model is made by particles that are simply particles of 300, 500, one TV, okay, that's acceptable. Or if at the end of the run of LHC, you won't see any of them, then you will be in trouble with the supersymmetric model as such, because then you have to invent a reason for admitting that that particles can be can have a much higher energy and still being able to make the effect for which you have invented them. Okay, we'll see. I mean, the future will tell the truth. But certainly, in this very moment, beyond standard models are not extremely popular. That does not mean that we understand why things work. It's a different story.
Okay, thank you. Maybe other questions? You can try to raise your hand if people have other questions. Maybe in the meantime, I have one question. Could you please, Fernando, explain again what is the difference in sensitivity between argon and xenon?
Argon and xenon are different in this respect. There is a bit of different threshold, but that is not fundamental. The difference is here. The difference is here. Now, I do not have the same picture for argon, but if I had, you would see that S2 is very, very, very big, okay, compared to S1. Now, if S2 is very, very big, this allows you essentially to start to deal with the difference between the recoil of the scattering of a neutron on a nucleus and the scattering of a particle which is heavier than a nuclear, although with less velocity. So it will essentially help you in killing whatever interaction is not due to a particle, to a slow particle of big mass. Okay?
Okay, I see.
Thank it you. Will not help at low mass, not a well. It will not help at low mass. Here you see that while the sensitivity in the region 10 GV, 1000 GV, can be, and the neutrino floor is assumed that is below here. The sensitivity is very, very, very good. You see that at very low mass, something prevents the noble liquid to be good. Actually, many experiments are prevented to make progress there. The reason there is that you do not have enough signal. I mean, suppose that the dark matter particle is made by an object of 10 MeV, okay, slow. You can imagine that hitting a nucleus with a 10 MeV object, which is not even relativistic, it won't do much, right?
Yes, right, okay.
So there you have to change strategy. I don't think that this kind of experiments will be good.
Okay, thank you. I think we have another question by Fatima. Fatima, please ask your question.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yep.
Yeah, I was wondering how did scientists find and calculated the percentage of matter and dark matter and dark energy, and why dark energy is much more than others?
Why I try to tell you again, how is because it's a combination of measurement. Actually, the most precise comes from comes from the cosmic microwave background. Now, in the cosmic microwave background, what you have the picture of the universe at 380,000 years after the Big Bang. And what you observe are the correlation between the regions, the different regions of the universe, where the temperature is different by factors 10 to minus 4, 10 to minus 5. The best fit to those data is made with a few parameters. So, one of the parameters is the density, say, relative to one of the universe, and this omega comes one, so means that the universe is flat. And the other is that it tells you how much of the gravity, how much of the say the matter, whatever matter is. Because this determines the correlation between the temperature spots. And this tells you that the sum of dark matter plus the ordinary matter is of the order of 30%. At this point, the remaining 70% is not matter. It's not something that has to do with gravity, okay? It's not something that has to do with gravity. So it's an energy, there's no problem. Energy also has to do with gravity, but in a different way. Is part of the gravity of the tensor of the describe the universe, but okay, it's an event. Now, this experiment Planck. If you look at any paper from Planck, the Planck results, where the fit is made. There are even recent ones. So you understand what the essentially the technology or the fit and how it brings to the estimate of the parameters. Why is 70%? Now, the problem is that as we know that the quantity, the percent of dark energy has changed with time. We know, as for what we understand, for from this picture essentially, or where we know that in the past the universe was matter dominated, was not dark energy dominated. So this brings to the simple conclusion which has no explanation, that the dark energy component is proportional to the volume of the universe. So as long as the universe expands, the dark energy increases, okay? So at the beginning, if you take the picture of the universe at the beginning, matter was 100% and dark energy was zero. Okay, as long as the universe expands, dark energy starts to become a component. Since the universe is flat, omega is one, if you increase the component of one, you increase one component, the other have to decrease. So now we are in the point where we feel essentially that accelerating the dark energy is taking over. Okay. It's interesting because if we were doing this measurement 5 billion year ago, probably we would not have noticed this effect. So this is why I said that we are living in an interesting time. You see, this is 5 billion years ago. Perhaps we could have been so precise to detect, but it's difficult to detect something that is smaller and smaller. Now it's easy because dark energy is so big. On the other hand, the galaxies exist and the galaxies have been the seeds of the galaxies. The galaxies are the little disomogeneities that were present in the universe at the time when it was measured by the cosmic microwave background. and gravity made the galaxies to be denser objects than the rest of the almost empty universe. So that belongs to dark matter component. Okay, there is a lot of end waving here, and there is not a fundamental theory of this thing.
Okay, thank you. People have other
thank
questions.
You very much.
Maybe I can try another question. I don't remember if you said it, but when is the dark side experiment due to start, approximately?
It should start in 2 years from now.
Okay, thank you. Other questions in the audience?
Perhaps not.
Well, if not, then I think it's time to send a big thank to Professor Ferrani for this nice lecture. And we will continue with the lectures by next week and send messages to recall the lectures on Tuesday and on Thursday. And this was recorded, so Ketevi will put the MP4 file on the Indico page, and you also have the slides of Professor Ferrani on the Indico page. So I think we can call this session off for today. Thank you very much again, Fernando.
Thank to you, and thank to all the students that have followed the lecture. Thank you all.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.